Well, in the aftermath of that shameless recruiting plea to all of the students in this room, by the way, I'll join it. You will be happier at Edison than you'd be at Google, and I mean it. But you'd be happier still at NRDC, founded by John Bryson, Western office of which founded by John Bryson, energy project of which created by John Bryson, I took over in 1979. And what I would like to do is to first just tell you a story that he figures in that helps, I think, explain California's energy and climate leadership, and then tell you about something important that is still undone that I hope many of you will consider helping us accomplish together. Now, initially, on the matter of the story, Art Rosenfeld, who is a friend of many in this room, one of California's legendary energy and energy efficiency scientists, was asked in 2006, after Mary's favorite Republican governor got the climate bill passed, he said, the question from the reporter was, when is California going to start reaping benefits from its climate and energy leadership? And Art paused for a moment and said, well, I think it would be about 1973. And he was making the point, we've been at this for a long time, but in being at it for a long time, and something that emerged relatively early on, that's important, I mean, it's obviously exemplified by the tone of this panel, but in any other state, the principal regulatory officer, the head of the largest utility, and the environmental advocate would be simmering with unhappiness and would have a long history of animosity, which we might or might not successfully disguise from the audience. The California tradition that is, I think, more robust than anywhere else is that these interests have seen themselves in partnership for a very long time. And one of the things that made that possible is something that John Bryson accomplished when he was president of the California Public Utilities Commission. He became president at the age of 31. As an admonition to all in this room who can look at, think about the arc of a career, yes, I don't believe there's anyone else, and Louise and I would struggle to see if we could think of anyone, who had anything comparable to having founded a major national environmental group, been president of a state utility commission, and been president of the largest utility. Nobody else has done that. But by the act of doing it, what he helped people understand is that those interests were not fundamentally incompatible at all. And one of the things he had to do to establish that, because there was a conflict of interest, there was a fundamental incompatibility when he became president of the PUC, and that was the fact that all of the utilities in California had their financial health tied directly to increases in the use of natural gas and electricity. They could not recover their authorized costs, let alone make a profit, unless they met the equivalent of sales targets every year. And as long as you've got that, you can't be credible, as Ron Nichols emphatically is and just was in saying we've got to double down on energy efficiency, because you're cutting the throats of your shareholders or, if you're a public power, your bondholders. And Bryson was the commissioner who got through the commission, got established what is now an emerging regulatory norm in the country and the world, which is a simple reform that removes the linkage between utilities' financial health and their electricity and natural gas sales. Now, there are two ways to do this, and Bryson rightly brushed aside the obvious and easy one, just charge for electricity independent of use, like the cable bill. That would work, but then you've got the equivalent of all-you-can-eat rate, which is not exactly the greatest incentive for energy efficiency ever devised. He figured out a different and better way, involving small annual adjustments in rates that washed out the effect of any fluctuations in sales. It worked. It's been working in California for decades, and it broke out of the conflict of interest. It removed the conflict of interest that had been paralyzing progress in much of the country and certainly in California before that time. It is not a complete solution to the business model that will be required to realize the vision that Ron Nichols just put in front of you. And please recognize you heard something rather remarkable. You heard a utility executive tell you how he thought we should proceed together to decarbonize the economy. And no, they don't talk that way in Florida or anywhere else. And it is one of the reasons for confidence that we can accomplish that objective is that the heads of the sector that are most important to achieving it have fully embraced it and are showing how to do it. But there is one thing we have left undone, one important thing, and actually there are many, because we do have to double down on energy efficiency. We have much more to do on renewables. We have a host of innovations, some of which will be developed in this room to get installed in the grids, both distribution and transmission. But what I have in mind is a simple political act of will that we have now, for the fourth year in a row, failed to make. And the people in this room are uniquely equipped to understand why it is so important. I am talking about the effort to achieve a fully integrated Western electricity grid. And I remember well, 20 years ago, I was shown a map of the United States, and we were part of a task force I think it was the only federal task force ever created that Maxine was not on. And we were looking at, a guy named Phil Sharp was on it, who Dallas Boutreau knows very well, and many of you do, who is the chair. We were looking at reliability challenges for the U.S. grid, and the biggest single problem was its fragmentation. There were more than 150 separate balancing authorities in the U.S. charged with matching demand and generation, even though the grids themselves were much bigger. In the West, we had 34, way too many, by every account, the most fragmented single grid. 20 years later today, we have 38. It's gotten worse. It's not gotten better. The rest of the country has largely consolidated, has responded to that challenge and done something about it. We haven't. Now, why haven't we? We haven't because the entity clearly best equipped and capable of becoming the regional transmission operator, the California Independent System Operator, has one fundamental problem that prevents it from aggregating the West, that prevents it from recruiting everybody else. It's not its competence, which is outstanding. It's not the quality of its leadership, which is widely acknowledged. It's not the composition of its board, which is respected throughout the West. It's the fact that by California law, every board member for the California Independent System Operator has to be appointed by the governor of California. We have a wonderful governor, and confirmed by the Senate, the state Senate. So we have asserted political control over what ought to be a regional entity. And by doing it, we're preventing it from becoming a regional entity. We are sacrificing significant economic reliability and environmental benefits for our state and the entire region. We are creating an unintended barrier to decarbonization that affects us all. We have got to find the political will to do one simple thing. Have the California legislature release its control of the ISO board and authorize a transition to a fully independent board. That is all we need to do to begin a voluntary shift toward enhanced Western grid integration that will make incalculably easier all of the efforts, all of the objectives, all of the successes that Mary and Ron have talked about. We don't need the California legislature to decide who the new board will be. All we need them to do is to tell the existing board to execute a transition to a fully independent board. And then the great Western grid integration effort can begin. But for 4 years in a row, this has been stymied. It has been stymied primarily because, guess what? If you've got a fragmented system with lots of transaction costs, there are some who benefit from it, who will resist change. That was a problem Bryson faced at the outset of his career at the PUC. It's not an altogether unanalogous challenge today. And the ask, the specific concrete thing we have to accomplish together, there is one bill that will accomplish what is needed. It's called Assembly Bill 813. Its author is an assemblyman named Holden, who is pretty well known in this room because he's your assemblyman. He's the chair of the Energy Committee. He deserves your support, and he deserves your authoritative voices in response to those, and I'll just tell you what the two leading arguments against it are, because they help illustrate why. At the moment, what's really needed is disinterested, trusted expertise. The legislators don't have it readily available to them. They don't understand big power grids. They're confused. They're being told two things. One, if you move to a regional system, there'll be federal regulation, and Donald Trump will destroy California's climate leadership. Well, that would be an unappealing prospect. But the fact is that the California ISO is already fully subject to federal regulation. There will be no change if we move to a regional system. And in fact, happily, that happens to be the one federal agency, largely independent, that Donald Trump has so far showed no ability whatever to turn against a generally progressive arc. The second argument is that if you move to a regional system, unenlightened states on our borders like Utah and Wyoming will send coal flooding over the grid into California. And this is a place where an understanding of how grids work and how markets work is so important, because this room is full of people who understand that if you operate a regional power market, first thing that happens, it's the lowest cost resources to operate that win, that get to run, that get to displace the others in a competitive marketplace. And what are the lowest cost resources to operate in the West today? They're all renewable resources. If you want to move the system more rapidly and more cheaply toward a low carbon, environmentally preferred outcome, this is the best single way to do it, with economic, environmental, and reliability benefits to all of the states involved. But we've got to take one step together. Your assemblyman is trying to take it. Please help him. All I want to say in closing, and this is to all in this room who I hope want my job, as I once wanted John Bryson's job. The glorious thing about being in California at this moment on climate and energy policy is that you can make any of the three choices represented on this podium, government, the utility sector, or the burgeoning innovators that work with them as partners, or the environmental community and have a glorious opportunity to be part of California's next chapter in energy and environmental leadership.